As you know, we have this session on the Kashmir conflict, and before I introduce the two panelists, the third panelist is on his way, perhaps he'll join us later. Let me first say that while there are many a times in the Pakistani newspapers and in the Pakistani civil society and political area circles, we mourn when people are killed in Kashmir. But there is a spate of sectarian killings which are going on in the country. Last night, 84 people were killed in a blast once again in Quetta, an attack on Shia community, which is very sad, which hurts. As somebody said, when the whole country is burning, you people are having a literature festival. So my answer to them was that we are having it because we have to tell the message and give the message to the terrorists that you cannot suppress us, and we will continue talking and raising voice against this ruthless sectarianism or any kind of killings which are happening in the country against terrorism. So may I request all the guests, if not we can't do right now much, to observe 1 minute silence in memory of the people who were killed yesterday in the sectarian violence, or maybe in sectarian and other terrorism violence in the last so many years. On my left is Mr. Najmuddin Sheikh. Everybody in Pakistan knows him. He is a former diplomat and has been ambassador in many countries. And now we see him analyzing Pakistani foreign relations on various channels. So everybody is familiar. He's a regular writer in Dawn on these issues. And I don't think he needs much of the introduction. On my right is Victoria Sheffield. She is the writer on Kashmir conflict. She wrote a book, and the fourth edition has now come out. This alone shows, and as we all know, the conflict has been lingering on since 1947. And because of this conflict, the whole Pakistani politics has got distorted. Because of this conflict, we have had at least two direct wars, or jihads or adventures, I would call them, on the Kashmir issue alone, rather three. First, in 1948, we made the first mistake of life by sending a Lashkar and creating a private army. Up till now, we have not been able to get out of that framework, the establishment of Pakistan, of using the non-state actors. So non-state actors were first used then, and the same formula continued till you see it again in the Operation Gibraltar in 1965. You see it in 1999 when Musharraf sent the army people on Kargil and said that they are basically infantry people, but in the grab of the Mujahideens. So the whole jihadi culture has been built up around the Kashmir narrative, and from Kashmir conflict, the element of Pakistan becoming a security state. This aspect has actually distorted the Pakistan politics because it has become very sensitive. Nobody can say anything. But nevertheless, still, one of the things which has happened is that there are certain changes in the Pakistan stance over the period, which I will leave it to the panelists to talk about. So my first question to Najmuddin Saab to you is, and then I'll take the same question to Victoria. Do you see that initially Pakistan used to have a stand that Kashmir is a part of Pakistan? Then in the 90s, during Benazir Bhutto's time, we started saying that the Kashmiris should be allowed to decide, and we stopped emphasizing that much that it is part of Pakistan. So this shift continued moving. Then the LOC, you know, from the line of ceasefire, we started talking about LOC, and then, you know, soft borders and all those things. How do you see that? Are we changing? And the process is still on.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I think whatever the chronology, I think currently, or not currently, but up to 4 or 5 years ago, there was a question of India-Pakistan negotiations in the back channel, of which the parameters were that there can be no acceptance of the LOC, there can be no change of boundaries, borders, and within these parameters, how could cooperation between Kashmiris be encouraged and something be worked out. Those talks have been abandoned for some time. The situation in Kashmir, particularly in recent times, has been one of peaceful protest, and that peaceful protest now, I think our stance is coming closer. Our stance is coming closer and closer to the fact that we should see what is to the benefit of the Kashmiri people. And the Kashmiri people's struggle, whether you talk about the Hurriyat Mirwais or Hurriyat Gilani, there are obviously big differences between them. But nonetheless, there is this fact that at the moment, the struggle, the non-violent, peaceful struggle of the Kashmiri people seems to focus on securing a renunciation or a doing away with the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which has been a very difficult time, which has meant that at every street corner, the Kashmiris can be stopped, searched, and detained arbitrarily by the armed forces who have this particular strength or this particular authority under the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. So at the moment, and the last couple of days, of course, the hanging of Afzal Guru has brought about wide demonstrations, has brought this issue again to the fore. So if there was evidence needed of the fact that the Indian Army is regarded as an occupation army, and if that needed to be re-emphasized, I think the events of the last couple of days have brought that to the fore. But in terms of the Pakistani position, I think it'll be some time before, given the political climate in both countries, it'll be some time before there can be a substantive resumption of the dialogue, the back channel dialogue that was taking place, and that may end up by being what it should be, bringing benefit and bringing relief to the Kashmiri people, who, according to some figures, have lost more than 100,000 lives, and with thousands others who are missing or have been interrogated and brutally tortured, etc. Now, something that can bring an aid end to that is something that is required, and something that the Kashmiris are struggling for peacefully right now. The problem that appears to me is that if this peaceful struggle does not succeed in alleviating some of the problems that they face, then the leaders who are currently leading these peaceful protests may find that they have no choice but to revert to the use of violent means, and that would mean another difficult period in Indo-Pakistan relations and more strife within Kashmir itself.
Thank you. Victoria, what do you feel about what Mr. Najmuddin is saying, that if the peaceful struggle which is right now in Kashmir, if it is not given the concessions they are asking for, it may convert back into a militant struggle. Previously, there was a peaceful struggle. Then the jihadis got involved and it converted it into a militant struggle, which actually resulted in more killings of the Kashmiris. And it was not helpful. And the Kashmiris, some leaders started saying, please stop this, because beside that, it has brought sectarianism to our society. And they killed also some pandits, the Kashmiri pandits, and it became a communal issue from an issue of maximum autonomy or independence.
Well, I think...
Sorry. Well, firstly, thank you very much indeed for having me here to talk about Kashmir. I think what we're looking at, when you ask whether the danger of militancy coming back again into the narrative of the Kashmir issue, I've spent a lot of time interviewing a number of these militants and ex-militants in the Kashmir Valley, and I think what the general feeling is that militancy brought the issue out of cold storage. This is what's been said to me on a number of occasions, but the realization is that now, especially with the way the world is, the intolerance, so to speak, of freedom fighting, is that the issue has to be solved at the negotiating table. And whereas there is certainly an element of frustration, particularly among the youth, I personally don't feel that we're going to see the same militancy as took hold of the valley in the 1990s. But what I would really like to say is that I think the issue has changed dramatically. You mentioned 1947, you mentioned the tribal invasion. At that time, there was this feeling that the state of Jammu and Kashmir, the former princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, should go to Pakistan. This was the general feeling. As we know, the tribal invasion took place, and the idea was that a plebiscite should be held to ratify the Maharaja's accession or to reject the Maharaja's temporary accession. It was only ever meant to be a temporary accession. But what we've seen in the last 65 years is a movement away from Kashmir, in a way being traded as a piece of real estate between India or Pakistan. And I think the realization now is that the former princely state, as it existed, which includes Gilgit-Baltistan, Azad Jammu Kashmir, Ladakh, Jammu, the Valley of Kashmir, is not going to be either fully with India or fully with Pakistan. And particularly, what the insurgency in the 1990s did for the movement was to demonstrate this very vocal independence movement. The difficulty for everybody, and the difficulty in why it's become such a difficult issue to resolve at the negotiating table, is independence of what? Are we simply talking about independence of the valley? Are we actually talking about autonomy? Are we talking about Azadi? Because I think what the reality of 2013 now is that apart from the valley and apart from the Kashmiris of the valley, you're not going to see a change of territory of any other parts of the state.
You see, the thing is that, as you rightly pointed out, from an issue of geography and trying to get hold of Kashmir as a kind of a real state, now at least the human element has come up, and we talk about that what Kashmiris want would be acceptable to us. But at the same time, there is another dimension of this conflict. And one of the problem in this conflict is that Pakistan's main concern, as one of the Kashmiri leaders said, that you are making us fight and getting our boys killed only because you want to ensure your control on the rivers which flow to Pakistan. How do you look at that?
Well, I think, again, I mean, this is an issue which has come up more recently, was India's real desire of wanting to retain Kashmir. We always talked about Nehru's emotional attachment to Kashmir, his ancestral Kashmiri background, but was the real reason that the government of India wanted to retain control of the headwaters of the Indus River? And this is now, particularly as we're talking about climate change, we're talking about diminishing resources, this is becoming much more of an issue. Fortunately, despite the wars, the Indus Waters Treaty has held good, negotiated under the auspices of the UN in 1960. But I think, again, what we're looking at is a combination of both states wanting to retain control of the territory they've got. As we heard Najam Sethi earlier in his presentation, no country gives up land voluntarily. And what really is the issue is what is going to be the future of the Kashmir Valley given the aspirations of the Kashmiri people. And I think this is the issue that is so difficult to resolve because nobody quite knows how you can reconcile divergent interests of a very small part of the state without ratifying essentially the breakup of the state. For example, if you go to India, you cannot get a map of the Kashmir which shows the line of control because according to the constitution of India, the whole state still belongs to India. As we know, President Musharraf enunciated it, but it's been the policy of successive Pakistani governments, is that the line of control is unacceptable. So amidst these varying viewpoints, where is there a peaceful resolution for the Kashmiri people? And this is a thorny issue which we're trying to address, but every time there's a breakdown in relationship between India and Pakistan, the Kashmir issue gets put on the back border and on the back burner, and every time it's put on the back burner, you have a continuing low-level insurgency and you have continuing deaths. And I think having visited the Valley of Kashmir myself, having visited the graveyards of the martyrs, which now incidentally is over 100,000, on a conservative estimate, while the issue is not being resolved and it's continuing on and on, you have continual deaths, and this is what we want to prevent, not to mention the disappearances and the widows, because these widows who've got the disappeared husbands can't remarry and the livelihood is very difficult.
Sheikh Saab, what do you think on this water issue basically which we have and which our strategists keep on telling us that it's very important to resolve that? 1960s water treaty did resolve it, but then the issue of building many dams on the rivers came up, and now this issue is hyped up in Pakistan by certain lobbies who don't want to have a good relation with India, and maybe out of their own perception, their legitimate concerns that eventually because of this dam, Pakistan will get less water.
Well, I think what we need to do is to carry out a non-partisan evaluation of exactly what is possible and what threat that offers to the free flow of water that belongs to Pakistan under the Indus Waters Treaty, how far that can be interfered with. One example that is often quoted is that if India builds 8 dams on the Chenab River and then releases the water that is the dead water storage, it is going to flood Pakistan. I think we in the evaluation we would also take into account that if they were producing say 4000 megawatts from these 8 dams, those 4000 megawatts would cease to exist and would cease to exist for at least 30 to 35 days while the rivers were being filled up or the dead storage was being filled up again. So I think we need to do a much more cautious evaluation so that we know exactly what are the risks involved. And above all, I think we should be clear that the Indus Waters Treaty is relatively unique. No other two countries, no lower riparian has been able to get the sort of safeguards that are built into the Indus Waters Treaty. If we need change, and I'm moving beyond your question, if we need change in the Indus Waters Treaty, we need it to ensure that there is watershed management of the type that is required. Obviously, our interest in the watershed management is greater than that of India because India is not as overwhelmingly dependent on the Indus water system as we are. But for the moment, that watershed is not in our control. And that is perhaps one reason why we should be concerned, particularly with climate change and what that will mean for the continuous flow. Let me say that at the moment, what I have been able to see with regard to water flows, there has been no particular diminution in our water flows. Water availability per capita has declined, but that has not declined because there is less water. It's merely that your population has grown. And I think we should also bear in mind that of the water that we use, 5% is for human consumption. The rest is for agriculture. So we should have a reasonable idea of what exactly is involved. So what does the dams, construction of dams mean? If those dams are used to your disadvantage, what is the disadvantage that India would suffer? And is it in India's interest to create that particular situation or is it not? And then we can move on from there to look at this particular issue. We've always said that Kashmir is the jugular vein because it controls our water supplies. I think this issue needs to be seen by our experts in a neutral, non-partisan way to determine whether it is in fact so or not. With regard to the other question as to where we are in terms of renewing or looking again at the series of talks that were abruptly ended around 2008 based on the parameters that President Musharraf had laid out. I think one of the things that worries me now is that while those remain in abeyance and realistically will remain in abeyance until our elections are over and perhaps even until the Indian elections have been held, there is a situation developing on the ground which is not very comfortable. The incidents that have happened on the line of control are rather a break in terms of the amount of publicity attached, are a break from what was the position from 2004 when the ceasefire came into effect. That seems to suggest some change in India, which we need to watch. I have a feeling that perhaps the publicity that is attaching to minor incidents, and frankly those incidents were minor, may be related to the Indian Army's desire to resist what some Indian politicians are prepared to agree to, namely the doing away of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act and the arbitrary authority that the Indian Army enjoys in Kashmir under that particular lamp. So if there is to be some degree of easing, certainly every Kashmiri leader on the eve of India's Republic Day repeated this requirement that the Armed Forces Special Powers Act should be done away with. If there has been peace in Kashmir, and one of the Indian correspondents, Shekhar Gupta, a man who usually researches his stories very well, said that in the last year there had been only two deaths on the line of control. There had been only minor incidents within Kashmir itself. And now the Kashmiris have seized upon this and said, given this situation, given the fact that peace prevails in Kashmir, why can't the Armed Forces Special Powers Act be rescinded? And I think the Army's response is, no, we are having incidents on the line of control and we can't do it. This is something that I think it's in everybody's interest in this area for this to be this excuse not to be accepted in New Delhi. Whether there are any chances of that, I don't know. But this is one of the things that we need to focus on, because Kashmir can very easily become a point of great difficulty between India and Pakistan, even while efforts are being made to put that relationship on a more even keel. Thank you.
Well, you rightly pointed out that the recent incidents which happened actually created a lot of pressure actually on the Indian government. I launched myself in Delhi on the same day when this thing happens, and the whole Indian media went berserk and jingoistic. I thought all guys are jingoistic, but the television over there was very jingoistic, and they were calling me also and saying you killed and all that. I said, please excuse me. So these kind of things actually forced the government also there to come out eventually some statement. But as I felt at that point that we have maybe one, Hafiz Saeed and Hamid Gul, they have also quite many. And that was the problem. Victoria, looking at the recent developments, do you think that this will delay the process of, as Najam Saab said, of normalizing issues on Kashmir? Or do you think that it will have to wait till the elections in both the countries.
Well, unfortunately, sorry, this is not working either. I'll get back to my other mic. Sorry. It was just I thought it wasn't working. I'm going to try like this because I felt I was not looking at the audience properly. I think obviously when elections take place in countries, it's a very good opportunity to put thorny issues on hold. And so I think there's not going to be any movement on the Kashmir issue until after both the elections in Pakistan and the elections in India. But I also think it's part of a bigger issue because we're talking about peaceful negotiations and we're talking about talks. But what we're really talking about is talks on talks. And until there's a real plan as to what might be the future resolution of the issue, we're just talking about the issue, but without really moving forward on it. And until you move forward on it, you can't resolve situations like what do the Kashmiris want, like the removal of the, as they call them, draconian laws, like the further reopening of the line of control. It is still, despite all the time that's passed, hasn't been formulated in the leadership's minds as to what would be a reasonable settlement of the Kashmir issue. And actually, if we're really honest, that's the thorny issue that faces all negotiations and why it's a very good reason to just not negotiate, because nobody can quite decide. We had the 62-63 talks, we had the idea of the Chenab River, there was the possibility of partition of the state. And I think what we're looking at, unfortunately, for those Kashmiris who would like to see independence of the whole state, is that eventually the issue will be resolved along some sort of partition. Because as I've mentioned, you have certain areas which are already comfortable in the region in which they are now owe allegiance to. For instance, Gilgit-Baltistan, Azad Kashmir, Ladakh, Jammu. So we're really faced with the valley. But as I say, we talk around the issue without really looking at the end game. And I think until there are politicians on both sides of the border bold enough to look at the end game, we're going to continue to talk about the Kashmir issue and stumble from one set of talks to the other with interruptions, whether it's a military interruption because there's a firing on the line of control, or it's a political interruption because there've got to be elections.
I think with this, I will open the floor for questions from the audience. Let me get the first question from here. Please, the gentleman in the suit. But sir, please keep your question very brief. Formulate it as a question, not as a statement.
When it comes to Kashmir, we all know that India is a major stakeholder. And you all discussed that countries or states don't allow separation that easily. So when it comes to the separation of Kashmir or any settlement of the Kashmir, don't you think that India doesn't have any incentive other than the status quo? Because separation can only be possible with either militant movement or international pressure, which forces those countries to allow that kind of separation. When it comes to India, they have withstood three wars, Kargil, proxy wars, everything. It didn't make any difference to them. And when it comes to international pressure also, we don't see any international pressure on them despite all those resolutions passed in United Nations for the plebiscite. It doesn't abide them to conduct plebiscite really. So on what basis we can see that India is going to settle for anything, even when you talk about the armed forces, special rights being with doing away, they don't do it for the sake of making any settlement. I think
we got your question actually. Sheikh Saab, actually, the question is whether you got it. Okay, so can you please comment?
You're right in the sense that India has possession of a part of Kashmir, and it's not quite the same thing as was being discussed by Mr. Sethi this morning about separation or secession not being tolerated, because the fact of the matter is that from the perspective of the world, still Kashmir is a disputed territory. It's not an integral part of India. That is the Indian claim. The world has not yet accepted this Whether the world is moving closer to accepting it or not is another matter. But currently, the situation is that the UN resolutions are alive and well. They have not been nullified. But the reality today, and we're talking about the reality rather than the legal position or the moral position, the reality is exactly as you stated it, that does India have any particular incentive? First, I think the Indians are painfully aware of the fact that they are regarded as alien occupants in Kashmir. Second, Kashmir continues to present a fairly heavy burden financially. Third is not an argument for, it's an argument against, that we've taken whatever the costs have been in terms of the alienation of the Kashmiri people or in terms of the costs that have been incurred over the last so many years, and we can continue to sustain those. So we do arrive at a position of a slight impasse. Is there an incentive? Perhaps there is, that Kashmir continues to remain an issue that keeps this region from being as peaceful and as close together in regional cooperation as it could be. Do we need to find a solution? Can we find a solution which does not necessarily impinge upon what India believes have been its sacrifices in holding on, or the Kashmiri people for their sacrifices, 100,000 or more that have been killed, and the Pakistani position, which too is that we made lots of sacrifices, and lots of Pakistanis would say that we allowed our country to be torn apart as a result of seeking to secure the right of self-determination for the Kashmiri people. So there are these aspects that have to be looked at, and then to find a solution which satisfies the three parties, in not in full measure, but in some measure. The full satisfaction for any of the three, realistically, no matter what the moral position, no matter what the legal position, does not appear to be on the horizon. And therefore, how do we arrive at this solution which satisfies nobody in full, but which leaves nobody so dissatisfied as to ignore it altogether? That is the conundrum with which you are faced, and which you were seeking to try and resolve through the negotiations that were being attempted in the back channel. Perhaps we will be able to resume those and come to some solution. In the meanwhile, what I apprehend is really that in the meanwhile, if things go badly in Kashmir, then whatever efforts are made between India and Pakistan will suffer and will therefore create new areas of tension, where because of the 2004 ceasefire, those tensions had been abated. So that is my concern. I think that being realistic, I don't expect those back channel negotiations to be started very quickly. And in that interim period, I think it might be worthwhile, even from the Indian perspective, to try and reduce the measure of alienation by taking away the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. Because that, as far as one can see from reporting from Kashmir, has become a great, not just irritant, but a great discomfort and a great embarrassment for the Kashmiri people.
Thank you. Victoria, can I take this question to you in another form? With the coalition's government destined to be in India and Pakistan in the future, which are weaker to take any bold decision, and also on the both side, there is the people who live on the war economy and they are co-evolutionists of the army and all that. Is it possible to find a win-win situation between the three parties?
Well, I think it's a very difficult question, obviously. In fact, I'm sorry, I'm not doing very well with my mic today. If you had a consensus government, I can't emphasize strongly enough, being an outsider and looking in, that what both countries need is a consensus, coalition consensus, if the coalition government could turn into a consensus government with the opposition party to say that all our peoples of South Asia, our billion population and more, is suffering because we're hostage to an issue which occurred in 1947. As I've said before, the outcome could have been very different if certain steps had been followed, if, for instance, the plebiscite had been held at once, but it wasn't. But what we're looking at now is a perpetuation of both countries' relationship, which is not just a political relationship, it's an economic, social, cultural, the aspects of the youth, the internet, all wanting to coexist peacefully, but they're held hostage to the fact that they have the dispute over Jammu and Kashmir. And this is a situation we want to get away from. And I must admit, I've addressed so many conferences on Kashmir, and the fact that my book's in its fourth edition, I keep wishing that this would be the last time and that we would see some breakthrough. But you very rightly point out there are vested interests on all sides in maintaining the status quo, partly because there's a fear as to if we've not got the status quo, what's the next scenario going to look like? What, as I say, is the end game? And secondly, because unfortunately vested interests create an obligation in a way to stick to the position, because otherwise, you know, your particular interest is not served. But, you know, for real humanitarian clarity of the issue, you've got to say that what are we actually arguing about? We're arguing about the valley. We're not arguing now about the entire state of Jammu and Kashmir, because we know what the future disposition of that is. And Pakistan would be no more anxious if, for instance, you had a huge independent movement that took the whole state as an independent state, as the princely state that it formerly was, because it would lose Gilgit-Baltistan and it would lose Azad Kashmir. And we have to be very clear about that. So the political grievances, the draconian laws, not just that, the occupation, the military occupation, the disaffection is in the valley of Kashmir, 80 miles long, 20 to 25 miles wide. It's not a very big region. And this is why it begs the question, if we're talking about independence, are we talking about independence in the English sense, as we know what independence means? Valley of Kashmir is not going to want to have its own army, for example. Is it going to want to have its own currency? It's landlocked. It's not like a little tiny place in the middle of Europe called Liechtenstein or Monaco, where you can come and go. I vividly remember being in Srinagar, talking to a young Kashmiri and asking him, what is it you're really fighting for? And it was Azadi, independence. And I was playing slightly the devil's advocate, as a good journalist should, and I said, what do you mean by independence? Independence of the whole state, because then that's a very big issue, or independence of the valley? He said, oh, independence of the valley would be fine. I then said, well, it's very cold in Srinagar in the valley in the winter. What would you do in the winter? He said, oh, well, I'll go to my house in Jammu. So I'm trying to demonstrate, and I think sometimes we go round in circles talking about self-determination, but we don't want to reach what we mean by that. So are we talking about autonomy? Unfortunately, the word autonomy has been trashed because of what happened in 1953. So we have to find a new word. Are we talking about self-governance? Are we talking about Azadi freedom? Freedom as Kashmiris, fiercely proud people, both Hindus and Muslims, Kashmiri speaking. Are we talking about the cultural aspect of the Kashmir Valley that wants independence, that wants self-government, that wants to run its own show and not be set upon by the government of India, not have Indian troops occupying? And I totally take Sheikh Saib's point. It's very demoralizing. I took my family and three children up to the Srinagar, to the valley in 2005, and as outsiders, they were appalled at soldiers on every street corner. It's very demoralizing to lead your life constantly with checkpoints and searches and be supposedly thought of as being a militant. But it really requires this vision for the leadership, because ultimately the answer does lie in talks between the governments of India and Pakistan with a representative voice from Kashmir, as how are we going to resolve this? Because otherwise our peoples are held hostage. We have huge arms arsenals. Why do we need huge arms arsenals? Why are we fighting each other? Because the Valley of Kashmir issue is unresolved?
The question from the lady here. Yeah.
thank you. Can you hear? Yeah. Just to give a tiny bit of context for my question, I actually have a business that is partially based in Srinagar and spend a fair amount of time there. And your description, Victoria, of the disaffection is just, it's so profound. And what I see happening is this building sense of fatigue. So people want this to be over. They don't want to be fighting. But they're so angry because this is a formerly very wealthy, comfortable place, and the economic livelihood has been destroyed. And so you have young men and young women, but particularly young men who can't get jobs, whose family had businesses and so on, and they're pissed off. So that's the backdrop. What I see, because my business is run through India, is that the Indians, intelligent, educated, news-consuming Indians, actually don't have any knowledge of what's going on up there. There's not a formal embargo, but really there's not good information. And the Indian colleagues of mine that I've basically forced to come up there with me have been appalled at what they actually saw. They had no idea of the fear and the like cold hostility of this occupation. So, Victoria, can you kind of talk a little bit about why this embargo exists and this disconnect exists between the Indian people? Because I think if the Indian people had more actual knowledge, there might be more pressure.
Well, I think it stems originally from the fact that the narrative was created in 1947 that Kashmir was a part of India. And as I said, let's not talk about the bit that, you know, was, as they call it, occupied by Pakistan. I mean, let's focus again on the valley. And consequently, any movement of insurgency was a treasonable activity. And the media has been very carefully muzzled. What you do find, actually, are some very courageous journalists in Kashmir. But again, they've got to tailor what they say. So news only filters out. Plus, India is a very big place. And south of Delhi, nobody cares about Kashmir. They're not interested. And they also don't see any difference in the fact that the Kashmiris have just got to get along with it. But of course, it's hidden. The same way what's going on in Assam is totally hidden. Nobody's got any idea because nobody can go and report in Assam. So, you know, obviously any government that is dealing with an insurgency, quote, doesn't want it blasted headlines in the media. But I agree with you, once people go and see, they find that this disaffection is very great. It blows hot and cold. And for example, I remember when I went there in 2002 when the border was officially shut. The Kashmiris, they just got into computers. They just got the internet. As soon as something happens, the computers are shut down, the internet's cut off. And it's very cleverly controlled because, as you well know, when you go to Srinagar, you have a SIM card, you can use your mobile phone, but as soon as there's a bit of trouble, it stops. And so it's what one Indian journalist said to me, Kashmir will be always special because of its special status. The reason why it acceded to India was with special status. It'll always be suspect. And this is somehow in the Indian government mentality. It's certainly not in the Indian people's mentality. And I've also been very impressed by a number of Indians I've met when they hear about Kashmir or they've read my book or they talk to me and they say, you've been up in the valley, how is the situation? And now there are a number of courageous Kashmiri writers, for instance, Basharat Pir, Mirza Wahid, who are writing about the situation. But as I say, where I feel a sense of urgency is that you know, people do take up the gun, and going back to the original question, out of frustration, and this is certainly what happened in the 1989-1990 period. We'd had the rigged elections, now acknowledged to have been rigged in 1987. People forget that Saeed Salahuddin, who sits in Muzaffarabad of the United Jihad Council, actually contested the elections in 1987. So did Abdul Ghani Loan. A number of people contested those elections, but they felt so frustrated they took up the gun. I personally don't think it's ever going to take on the same proportions as it did before, because as I say, there's this world movement against jihadism and freedom fighting. But nonetheless, you're going to have this disaffected youth that are hanging around without the jobs, who may again resort to sporadic violence. So therefore that gives the excuse for the Indian Army to say there is this violence, we therefore have to retain our presence. And it's a catch-22 situation. It goes round and round. Take the stone throwing. 2 years ago, you had the young boys throwing stones. You then had a police reaction. You then had some dead martyrs. You then had a big funeral. You had more stone throwing. So if you don't have this political will to think, what are we fighting about? Why can't we resolve the political future of this small area in the subcontinent? You're going to continue to have this on-off and on-off relationship between India and Pakistan as well.
Is not the solution independent Kashmir?
Is not a solution independent Kashmir? Shall I plunge in with this one, Najmuddin, or would you like to take this? A number of Kashmiris do say that the solution isn't having an independent Kashmir. And I mean, just to formulate our history, Kashmir as a state was created in 1846 by the British in order to create a buffer against the rising power of the Sikhs. So it's not a very old state as an independent state, and it was put together out of these disparate jagirs from the region. And Raja Gulab Singh was set up as a Maharaja. So we are talking about an area that was independent as it exists geographically for 101 years. But the difficulty now, if you talk about having an independent state, it requires both India and Pakistan to relinquish territory. And as we've heard, no country relinquishes territory voluntarily. In addition to which, it requires the will of the people in that area. And I think if you had a regional plebiscite in the areas we're talking about, you would find that you did not have a unitary vote. And when the British, it was Lord Mountbatten who suggested that the Maharaja's accession be confirmed by a unitary plebiscite, there was no provision for a regional plebiscite. You would have disaffected minorities. You would definitely have disaffected minorities in Ladakh, because with great respect to Pakistan, there's no movement in Ladakh to become part of Pakistan if the vote went towards Pakistan. Equally, you'd have disaffected minorities living in Gilgit-Baltistan if the vote went to India. That's why the plebiscite was a flawed idea. But I'm not sure that these areas now, they're used to where they are, and if you gave them a regional plebiscite for independence, I'm not necessarily sure they'd want to come into an independent state. But again, it could be determined by a referendum, if you could have a referendum that was free and fair and impartial. But that's the difficulty. But I don't see the government of Pakistan permitting it myself, permitting loss of the northern areas. They've built the Karakoram Highway through up to Kunjarab. And I don't see the government of India letting go of Ladakh, or indeed Jammu, where a number of Hindus predominate. So this idea of independence, we talk about it, and certainly a number of Kashmiris talk about it, but is it practical in the world we live in today? Is it a realistic prospect? Which is why we focus attention on the valley, where there's actually disaffection.
Hello. I just wanted to know your opinion about what I believe. I see the solution of Kashmir or the independence of the Kashmir is more than a romantic illusion, unless there is a Mujahideen from establishment of Pakistan, those who are using the escort for the diplomatic issue for the Indians when you are talking about the economical social issues. I just wanted to know your opinion.
Who is this question for?
For the both panelists.
You ask. I've spoken enough.
All right. As I understand your question, you think that economic and other pressures are going to drive towards independence or drive towards no independence? I'm not sure whether you wanted one or the other. But let me try and address the question generally and to perhaps supplement what Victoria said earlier with regard to the myth of Kashmir as a sovereign princely state that had been in existence and that had created what is called Kashmiriyat. I think Kashmiriyat very largely is a valley proposition. It's not something that is necessarily shared in Ladakh or in Jammu or in what is very largely Azad Kashmir. In the language that they speak in Azad Kashmir is not quite the same. So there are these areas, and there was even an idea of the UN at one time, a Dixon proposal, that there be regional plebiscites, that with implicit with the regional plebiscites was that some areas might choose to go one way, some may choose to go the other way. But in all of them, there was no, in the ideas that were being exchanged at that time, there was no idea of independence or of independence with all the component units that formed the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir being together. Victoria said to you that what is the area of the valley? 25 miles by 18 miles?
18.
Yeah. So this is not a huge area, and this is not an area which is viable. We, and now I speak as a former diplomat, we always felt that the question of independence was being brought up as a red herring. And the response always was, first let's agree that there be a plebiscite. If we agree that there will be a plebiscite, then we can talk about what are the elements that they can vote on. They can vote for Pakistan, they can vote for India, which is what the resolution calls for, or you can add independence. But first, get the Indians to agree that there should be self-determination, there should be a plebiscite to determine what the Kashmiri people want. So I think we come back to what I had suggested earlier, that eventually the solution will be one that satisfies no one in full. There are three parties. All three parties, their concerns have to be addressed. And some of the concerns that they have will have to be set aside so that a compromise solution can be worked out. It is the time frame that worries me more. As I have said before, and I'd like to repeat, that this is possibly not going to happen until, as Victoria said, there are consensus governments which in the two countries which decide that they are going to look for a solution. And that doesn't seem to me to be happening in the immediate future. So the time till this can be done is a time that can be very difficult for Indo-Pakistan relations, for the Kashmiri people, and that for the moment I believe that efforts should focus on trying to reduce those tensions and to bring some relief to the Kashmiri people. Thank you.
Najim, the last question from the gentleman at the back with the Chitrali cap. Mm.
Thank you. The Chitrali cap and the Kashmiri shawl, incidentally. The question I have is the 25 square miles of the valley, because I don't think that Hazrat Baal is by analogy like the Dome of the Rock. This is not Jerusalem we are talking about. This suggestion has been brought up for resolving the Palestinian crisis as well. And the moment you prioritize Jerusalem or even East Jerusalem, what you do is you undermine, you know, the rest of the West Bank. There are people in the rest of the West Bank, as they are in Kashmir, you know, where they are ancestral homes, they are intermarriages. So I'm not entirely convinced if this suggestion really works.
Well, I think what your question is that we must still consider the whole of the valley, and I'm sorry, the whole of the state. And I'm certainly not saying you can just plunge in and talk only to Valley Kashmiris. You've got to have a representative selection of the entire state. But what I am saying is that I think one has to determine what the people in the respective regions all want. And on the basis of what we know already, I think it's unlikely that they're all going to want the same thing. And as Sheikh Saab said, in terms of a win-win, we're not going to have a win-win because you're going to have certain people wanting certain things. But the reason for focusing on the valley is because that's where the insurgency has taken place. And that's where you've seen this real disaffection. That's where there are an enormous number of troops. It's a militarized area. I don't know, have you been yourself? Are you from the valley?
Well, I'm more familiar with Muzaffarabad and Dhirkot and Rawalakot.
Okay. So you're not so the Pakistani AJK, side. From your AJK, no. Yes. So you haven't actually been to the valley. So you haven't seen the militarization of the valley. And that's why working out, that's where the large, I mean, if we're talking about the 100,000 people who've died, they're mainly from the valley. So I think it's natural that one has to look at what their disaffection is. But at the same time, the whole state, if you're going to get rid of the dispute as it existed in 1947, obviously you've got to have discussions with the entire state. But what I am saying is that I don't think it can be valley driven for the whole state, because you'll end up having disaffected minorities in the rest of the state if you go with simply what the valley might want.
With this, I thank you both the panelists for giving a new, bringing in new angles also, particularly that how the different parts of Kashmir can be dealt separately. It was almost looks like close to the Musharraf formula when he said divide it into five areas and then look at it in each one independently. With this, I will thank you all for giving a very good food for thought for people on the issue which I don't know haunt us how long, and how long Pakistanis and Indians will remain hostage to this valley issue.